point of logistics this morning. The hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor, is in the green hymnal number 108. 108 when we get to that point. Green hymnal number 108 for All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Please stand as you are able. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. The Holy Gospel according to the book of Matthew, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet Zechariah, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ." Number 108.
Children will sing Hosanna's ring.
Go ahead and hand them out. Yeah. Go ahead and hand them out. Go ahead and hand them out. Yep, go hand them out. Yep, go hand them out. Go ahead and hand them out. Yeah.
Glory. Of children and sweet Hosanna sing. The company of angels are praising you on high. Creation, all mortals in chorus.
Raise them high when you got them.
Glory, loud and honor to you. Of children made sweet Hosanna sing. To the pilgrims over the heaven, and heaven prayer and anthems before we present it. All glory, loud and honor to you, Redeemer King. Of children made sweet Hosanna's ring. To you before your passion they sang their hymns of praise. To you now high exalted our melody of praise. Glory, loud and honor to you, Redeemer King. Of children made sweet Hosanna's ring.
Kids, come on up. Come on up here and stand up front. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Okay, people, we need to do better than that. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. All right, raise your palms high, everybody. We're going to do a blessing of the palms. Raise your palms high, everybody. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through your Savior, Jesus. Today, he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow Jesus in the way of the cross, so that joined in his death and resurrection, we enter into new life with you. Through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the high. One more time. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And the congregation, please be seated. Thanks, you guys, for your singing and helping us to celebrate today. Keep on waving those palms really high today, okay? Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this glorious Sunday morning, Palm Passion Sunday. And we thank you to the kids for helping us to raise our palms high. And so I encourage you, this morning, especially towards the beginning, as we transition to Passion, we raise those palms high. A couple of announcements before we begin. A prayer request for the family of Steve Wright and his family as we celebrate the life of Steve's father, Bill, who passed away last August. However, we're holding a burial on Wednesday at Fort Snelling National Cemetery, so prayers be with Steve and Bev and family this morning and this week. In this springtime of the year, with planting season upon us and the work of the fields and farms that are upon us and begin new again, We're doing a blessing. I'll be doing a blessing of seeds, of soil, of water, of tractors, whatever you want. I'll come and show up, and we'll do a blessing in the fields if you are in your yard, wherever. If you would like that, please talk to me sometime this week or in the weeks to come. And I know some of you planting won't start until May, and so we've got some time. But if you want to get early in on that, please come talk to me afterwards. This morning is a full morning. As far as worship is concerned, we are blessed to be able to celebrate alongside Grace and her family and friends for her baptism. This is an opportunity for all of us to remember our baptism as well, especially as we look ahead to this week, Holy Week, where we journey alongside Jesus to the cross and to his resurrection. And in our daily lives as baptized Christians, we remember our own baptism as well, and dying to ourselves in the water and coming out of the water, rising back up out of the waters as new people, as beloved children of God, beloved, forgiven, and blessed and sent people of God. So thank you to Grace for allowing us to share with you in this day. And a part of that is the certificate which Grace will receive after worship. And the certificate says, "We welcome you into the body of Christ and the mission that we share." And it has Grace Susan Christensen, her name, in the middle. And so what I'd encourage you to do is I'm going to start it over here with Alice. We're going to pass it through the congregation. So please make sure it kind of gets through the congregation by the end of the service. Sign your name to it. And this will be a kind of give to her as a gift, as all the witnesses that were here today in witnessing her baptism as well. So we're going to start over here, Allison, if you want to sign that and pass it on that way. Thank you. Today is Palm Sunday, but it is also Passion Sunday. It's a day that we celebrate when Jesus came riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, and the crowds that were celebrating and dancing and cheering him on, the Messiah had finally come. But it's also a day that we look ahead to the week that is to come, this week, Holy Week, because the celebration doesn't last long for us. It kind of is this climax today, and then it kind of goes towards the cross this week. And as the days ahead, sooner on, we'll turn towards that cross and Christ's journey towards the solemn and mournful day of his crucifixion. So today is a drama for us within the context of worship. And we have this drama of celebrating starting to look towards the cross here in a few minutes. So my friends, I invite you to journey alongside each other as a community of faith, as we together, not only today, but also throughout this week. Monday, Thursday, with First Communion for four of our young people on Thursday evening at 4:00. Come for that. Monday, Thursday, we celebrate the Last Supper of Jesus and his disciples. On Friday at 7:00, we will celebrate, or we will honor Good Friday and Christ's crucifixion at 7 p.m. through a tenebrae service, a service of darkness. And then on Easter Sunday, with worship at 8:30 and 10:30 with breakfast in between. So please come for that, and a big celebratory Sunday, Easter Sunday morning. So come one and all to the week that awaits all of us to experience and journey together. May God bless and continue our worship this morning. Let's stand as you are able as we sing All Glory, Laud and Honor, number 5, verse 5 of 108 in your green hymnal. The congregation, please be seated. And I direct your attention to the insert in your bulletin, the service of holy baptism, as we follow along and participate as well, you'll have a part in this morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. In baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity, and by water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the church, the body of Christ. And living with Christ and in the communion with the saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. Parents and sponsors, as you have presented Grace Susan to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with the following responsibilities: to live with grace among God's faithful people, to bring grace to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, the Ten Commandments, to place in Grace's hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture her faith and prayer so that she may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world that God made, and work for justice and peace. So parents and sponsors, do you promise to help Grace Susan grow in the Christian faith and life and help her to live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church? If so, please respond, we do. Parents and sponsors, do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you away from God? If so, please respond, we do. The congregation, this is your part, promises that you're making on behalf of Grace as well. People of God, do you promise to support Grace Susan and pray for her and her new life in Jesus Christ? If so, please respond resoundingly, we do.
We do.
The congregation, please stand as you are able. I ask us all to profess our faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin and confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we baptize. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. All right, Grace, come on over. You all will have to come and see her eyes at some point. They're gorgeous. Grace Susan Christensen, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son. Hi. And of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. God, it's okay, you can hold her up. God, the giver of all life, pour out your Spirit upon Grace Susan, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and the Spirit of joy in your presence both now and forever. Amen. Grace Susan Christensen, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit. Yes, you have. And marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. Those fans are strong today. Grace Susan, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. And Grace, we have a number of gifts for you this morning that you'll receive afterwards. And so on behalf of the Nordland community, welcome to the body of Christ. Let's say these words together and welcome to Grace. We welcome you into the Lord's family. We receive you as a fellow member of the body of Christ, a child of the same Heavenly Father, and a worker with us in the kingdom of God. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with
you. Let's share God's peace and God's shalom with one another. God's peace, God's peace, God's peace, God's peace. God's peace, God's peace, yeah, God's peace. God's peace, God's peace. Dorothy, God's peace, look at her. God's peace. That's right. Second. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. Oh, she did. She did. She let me know. Hey, Chuck. Good morning. God's peace to you. God's peace. God's peace. Keep going, people. I'm not done yet. God's peace to you. Good morning. God's peace to you. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. Welcome back. God's peace. God's peace.
Good to get her back.
There you go, Dad.
Okay. I think you should just hold it the rest of the
day. Yeah.
All right. God's peace. The Lord be with you. As we now enter into the contemplation of the passion of our Lord Jesus and meditate on the salvation of the world through his suffering, his death and burial and resurrection, let us pray. Gracious and everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent Jesus to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, give us the strength and the courage to share in his journey towards the cross, dying to ourselves and in the glorious victory of his resurrection, experiencing the newness of life through Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll continue with our readings.
Bible. The Sovereign Lord has given me an instructed tongue to know the word that sustains the weary. He wakens me morning by morning, wakens my ear to listen like one being taught. The Sovereign Lord has opened my ears, and I have not been rebellious. I have not drawn back. I offered my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from mocking and spitting. Because the Sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I set my face like flint, and I know I will not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who then will bring charges against me? Let us face each other. Who is my accuser? Let him confront me. It is the Sovereign Lord who helps me. Who is he that will condemn me? The second lesson is found on page 1827 of your Pew Bible, and it's Philippians 2, 5 through 11. If your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. That is the name of Jesus. Every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please remain seated for our gospel acclamation.
The kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to the Gospel of Matthew, the 27th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And if you're following along, I'll be reading from the NRSV version, so it won't be quite the same as what you got in your pew Bible. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus said, "You said so." But when he was accursed by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave no answer, and not even a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner from the crowd and anyone whom they wanted. And at the time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. And while he was sitting at the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with this innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." And now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. And the governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" And all of them say, "Let him be crucified." And then he asked, "Why, what evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." Then the people as a whole answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole court around him, and they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And after mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. And as they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. And they compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall, but when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. And they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is the King of the Jews." Then two bandits who were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left, those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to, for he said, I am God's son. The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And so when some of the bystanders heard it, they said, this man is calling to Elijah. And at once one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. And then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth shook, and the rocks split, and the tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, truly, this man was God's son. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Here we are, Palm Sunday, Passion Sunday. And I want to tell you about the parade. Imagine this. People shouting and singing and dancing in the streets. They're breaking branches off palm trees and waving them to show the intensity of their joy and expectation and taking off their jackets, throwing them down and spreading them on the ground before Jesus as he goes by. And they're shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And then there's these little kids that are running around caught up in all the excitement about becoming part of this parade because Jesus had blessed them. And there's this man who once had a withered hand who is now cutting down those branches off the top of those palm trees and passing them out to all the others. And there's a person who was once deaf and mute and now he's leading the charge. He's leading the singing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Come on, people, let's say that together. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And then right in the middle of Jesus' path, people who were once crippled and lame are now dancing in the streets. An outcast, a person who was told that they had to live outside the walls of the city because they were different, who was told they didn't belong, is now in the middle of it all. And then that one woman, remember her? That woman, she had been bleeding for 12 years. And she touched Jesus' garment and she was healed. And now today, she's now there running alongside the donkey and she is singing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Come on, people. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And a blind man who now can see clearly, because Jesus healed him a while back. He saw Jesus today entering the city on a donkey and is walking alongside him. And the little girl raised from her deathbed, and now she brought her younger sister and her younger brother and her parents to the parade. And do you remember all those people that Jesus fed on the hillside? Do you remember that? They are the ones who brought all the food for the parade to share with others along the route. And then there's Jesus' mother and brothers who are looking up and down the street, realizing that all these people were now part of Jesus' family. All these people are caught up in Jesus' far-reaching arms of welcome. What a sight it is to behold. How beautiful it is. People, welcome to the parade. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Do it again. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna at the highest. And this parade, Jesus, who had earlier asked people to keep quiet and keep secret about who he really is, and now Jesus has finally thrown caution to the wind, and he's not even quieting the crowd or telling them to keep it down. It's a raucous event. And at the parade, Jesus is not only tolerating, but even encouraging shameless and outright worship from those who had witnessed all the great things he had done throughout his ministry. And they are singing, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest." And I want to tell you about this parade and give you a picture of this incredible day. Because, my friends, the days which are coming after this day, after the parade, the days which are coming are so frightening and sad. You see, there is this certain group of people at the parade who witnessed Jesus' incredible works and miracles and are excited and hoping to welcome this great warrior. They're expecting a Messiah, after all, to lead the people to political and military victory. That's the kind of Messiah they are waiting for. This certain group of people, they're expecting Jesus to strengthen their position in the community. But they aren't at all excited about worshiping Jesus that day because they want Jesus to be their king. They want Jesus to support their causes. They don't want a parade where people recognize Jesus as loving everyone. They don't want Jesus to question their motives. They don't want Jesus to question their positions of privilege because their intention is to continue to compromise with justice, to accept violence as a necessary evil. Their intention is to ignore the suffering of the people, to avoid responsibility of caring for their neighbors, because this is how they roll. This is how they do life. And I want to tell you a story of the parade, but I also want to spare you from the pain of watching Judas later this week betray Jesus for money. Spare you the disappointment when Peter denies ever have knowing him. Spare you the sight of the disciples fleeing when Jesus is arrested. Spare you hearing the crowds jeering at him, calling for him to be crucified. I want to spare you from flinching as Jesus is stripped and nailed to the cross. Spare you from having your soul experience sadness as Jesus cries out to God. Spare you the grief of the women who continue to stay with him at the cemetery. I want to tell you this story, but the truth is Jesus dies before the palm branches are cleared from the streets. I want to protect you from the shame of what Jesus did for us. I want to cry out to Jesus saying, "Jesus, you don't have to do this. We know that you love us. You don't have to go through with this." However, if we did that, that would mean we have to a complete lack of understanding of how God's love works. And it expresses our arrogance at wanting to protect even God from the vulnerability of love. I so want to protect you from Jesus' vulnerability, from Jesus getting hurt and being killed. And yet at the same time, I imagine that the deepest yearning of our souls, from the deepest depths of places of our souls, it's to witness and experience Jesus' vulnerability and to hear people at the foot of the cross whisper, "Truly, this was the Son of God." And to hear the criminal on the cross saying next to him, "Jesus, remember me in your kingdom." And Jesus responding to him saying, "Today you will be with me in paradise." I mean, really, folks, how else can we understand God's love for us? You and I, we need to hear the whole story. People of God, love involves a willingness to risk ourselves, put ourselves at risk. And God, who is love, was willing to risk great suffering, willing to risk betrayal and denial and desertion, willing to risk being mocked, willing to risk being misunderstood, to risk everything. My friends, this kind of vulnerability is perfect love. So how are we willing to put ourselves at risk for the sake of love? C.S. Lewis once wrote, "To love is to become vulnerable. It's to risk suffering. If you want to make sure your heart and your life is not broken, you must give your heart to no one, to nothing. Then and only then will it not be broken. If you give your heart to no one, indeed, it will become unbreakable." How are we, my friends, willing to put ourselves at risk for the sake of love? So while I want to tell you a story of the parade because I want you to know of God's love for you, I also have to admit that I want to ask Jesus to stop the parade, to turn around and go to safety, to quietly go back to Nazareth where it's safe, to get out of the middle of the street, to quit causing such a commotion. I want to protect Jesus from taking this whole being vulnerable of love thing and save him from this journey, the journey that lies before him in the days ahead. Love, my friends, is risky and messy. But thank God that Jesus chose to be vulnerable. And during the events of the week that following the parade, people who have witnessed Jesus' love found themselves to be in a place of vulnerability as well. For the days after the parade were frightening and scary and sad for the community of faith. The people who followed Jesus in the parade became a part of that messiness of love. They could have taken their loved ones home from the parade and shut themselves off from the events of the rest of the week in an effort to protect themselves from the messiness of love. And yet, if they did that, they would be cheated from the reality of God's love for them, being cheated from what it means to love one another. Love is risky and messy. People of God, we could decide for ourselves to be content this week with only hearing the story of the parade on Palm Sunday and then skip right over to Easter and the resurrection. However, if we're going to have a story in which we can live and die for, which is what Jesus calls us to do, my friends, we need the whole story. And so while I want to tell you the story of children shouting Hosanna, of people singing and dancing and waving branches and being merry in the streets in praise of the one who came to be their Savior, we also need to tell and hear that God's love is for us. And it puts God in a place of vulnerability. And at the same time, let's remember that God is ever faithful, willing to risk suffering in order to bring life out of death, willing to bring hope out of fear. Jesus goes ahead of us to the places we don't know, to the places where we aren't comfortable going, and gives us the strength to risk love. So, my friends, where is that place for you? Where is that place for you where God is calling you to risk love, risk being broken, risk the messiness that goes along with love? On this day, Palm and Passion Sunday, Jesus is not done with his story. He's not done showing how much God loves you and I. So, my friends, here we go. Let's go on this ride together, this journey
of Holy Week together. Thanks be to God for the whole story. Amen.
We'll continue with our hymn, What Wondrous Love Is This? We'll continue with our offering. Please stand for offertory. Thank you, Olivia.
A fragrant offering, a loving sacrifice, the life of Jesus Christ for us, your children, given, and every blessing which you have given us, we share with others at our offering to you. With thankful hearts, may it be fragrant, God, to you.
Please join me in the prayer litany. Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." In the name of Jesus, we pray, Lord, help us take up our cross and follow you. You stood before Pilate, your life condemned, your word rejected, your innocence ignored. Keep us from rejecting your word of truth and salvation. You carried your cross for love of us and for the world. Help us to bear your cross for love of you and for love of others. The weight of your cross was the weight of sin which make us stumble and fall. In our weakness, we turn to you for strength. Hear us as we pray. Forgive us, O God, for the sins which make us fall. When we stray, lead us to a life of repentance, grace, and humility. We thank you for the depths of your love for us. In these days to come, keep us close, and we journey away from the celebration of waving palms toward the darkness of your death on the cross.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For
now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn, Lead Me to Calvary.
Forget thy agony, lest I forget. forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thy agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me, like Mary, through the gloom, come with a gift to thee. Calvary, lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thy love, for me, lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to hear daily my cross for thee, even thy cup of grief to share, thou hast over me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thy agony.
Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.